Hey everybody, it's Fran, again in the lab. Today, very special video that I've been planning to do for a long time, just kind of waiting for, the right time to do it. It's about slide rules. These amazing gizmos that most people recognize from Apollo 13. When they use the slide rule to do addition, whatever. But slide rules are actually still quite handy tools, which I'll show in a moment. This is my dad's slide rule. It was his college rule. It's a Dietzken, number 1767, but it's a very common type of slide rule. They came in several different kinds of orientations and configurations. Some of them had one slide, some of them had multiples. I remember seeing the really complicated slide rule that belonged to Wernher von Braun that's at the Air and Space Museum. But they all kind of run on the same principle, which is that they use logarithms to calculate results very quickly for multiplying, dividing, doing trig functions, logs, exponents, roots. Very easy to use, although I think in modern times people were using calculators like this fancy modern. Once we had these that we could put in our pockets, if I had a pocket, kind of made slide rules obsolete for most things, although having a little analog calculator is very handy for doing some very specialized things. I still use a slide rule, this one, for doing scaling, which they are still very handy and quick to do, still kind of the fastest way to do scaling for drawings and things like this. Like when people think of slide rules in people who are young enough to have never used one, including myself, because when I was growing up, I grew up with calculators, got my first calculator in 76, so I never even really learned to use my dad's slide rule, although I've had it forever. A lot of people would think, well, how did they ever get to the moon using slide rules? And I guess the real answer is that they didn't. Not that they didn't get to the moon, but slide rules were never used for precise calculating. That's really not what they're for. They were always used to do quick calculations to get results for things that were not requiring several decimal places of accuracy. These things included drafting, mechanical and architectural drafting, scaling drawings, and even working in the field, getting quick measurements for framing houses, laying brick, cutting lumber, even doing like carpentry, things like this, where you just need a quick result, a calculation that just has to be about right, and you don't want to have to pull out logbooks and look up trig functions and do long math. You can just kind of look it up and eyeball it and get a pretty good idea of where to put the dot or where to cut the wood and such. And that's kind of where slide rules still work. In fact, there were lots of implementations of the idea of slide rules, of having logarithmic sliding charts. Here's one that came from the reactants slide rule from Shore. That even came with a really cool, handy instruction booklet from the Shore brothers. Belonged to Jay Palava at Philco Corp. So Philco is using Shore's, calculator. But it works on the same idea of a slide rule. Okay, so on one side you've got your reactance charts, right? And on the other side you got this capacitance rule. You got the frequency ranges and inductance, stuff like that. Works the same way as a slide rule. Two different logarithmic scales that you interpolate because of the interference. Slide rules work on a very interesting human principle, because human beings have the ability to detect the intersection of lines very precisely by eye. It's one of the peculiar traits that we have, and so slide rules work very well because we're able to detect pretty precisely when two lines of the same thickness are in absolute alignment to a surprisingly precise degree. And without even knowing it, each and every one of you has probably used a slide rule we still use in the day. Veneer calipers, it's a slide rule. It's using the same principles that the slide rule uses. By detecting the intersection of two different scales, you can really easily calculate measurements to another decimal point, or several decimal points, depending on how long the scale is, you know. But veneer calipers, if you know how to use one of these, then you know how to use a slide rule, because you've already used one. Here's another one. This one is a slide rule that measures the filters, you know, has a little handy information window there that you can, as you slide it, you can get the particular type of filter and such. Oh yeah, and on this side you have a handy universal conversion chart. So this is where slide rules are very handy, where you have, you know, fixed standards like converting imperial to metric or gallons to quarts or how many liters are in an ounce. It's very easy to put those on, you know, a logarithmic chart and put it in a slide rule, and you can very quickly look up a number. Again, if you're not having to do it to several decimal places, a slide rule works just fine. Now here's another one. This converts a slide rule for volts to decibel power level. That's pretty handy. It's decibels, current voltage ratio. Yep. Still very handy. It's pretty cool, you know. Slide rules like these little pocket cardboard things, they used to be ubiquitous. Everyone used to make them, and I guess a lot of people still do make them because they're still very handy and work very well for converting any kind of scale to any other kind of scale. Okay, so how do you use a slide rule, and what are all the markings about? So my dad's slide rule, it still has the original instructions. I have never really unfolded it because it's very brittle, but for this video, I think I'm going to try. Maniphase slide rule. How to use a slide rule. A slide rule is an instrument for performing mathematical operations quickly and easily, and yet with sufficient accuracy for most engineering computations. The slide rule is based on logarithms, and those familiar with the use of logarithms know that to multiply, the logarithms of the numbers are added together. To divide, the logarithms are subtracted. A slide rule makes the necessary addition or subtractions of logarithms mechanically. It should be remembered, though, it is not necessary to understand logarithms to be able to use a slide rule. Couldn't have said it better myself. This slide rule has application to problems involving multiplication and division of numbers, squares, square roots, proportions, percentages, trigonometric functions, logarithmic functions, and combinations involving all of these phases of mathematics. To the uninstructed student or layman, the slide rule may appear difficult to understand because of the confusion caused by the numerous scales. However, in reality, it is very simple to operate. By far, its greatest use is confined to multiplication and division, and the beginner is advised to devote his first study to simple operations in these two phases. Okay, so here's a description of the slide rule. The D scale is used with the C scale for multiplication and division, right? The C scale, identical to D scale and used with D scale for multiplication and division. The A scale used with C and D for finding squares and square roots. I'm going to show that. The B scale, identical to the A scale, also used with the C and D scales for finding squares and square roots. K scale. Do I have a K scale on here? Oh, I do have a K scale. Okay. The K scale used with C and D scales for finding cubes and cube roots. The CI scale, a reciprocal scale used with the C and D and T scales, which is basically just the inversion of the C scale. S scale, a trigonometric scale used with the A and B scales for problems involving the sine of angles. The T scale, a trigonometric scale used with the C and D and CI scales for problems involving tangent of angles. And the L scale, used with C and D scales for finding logarithms. All right. Well, this is a close-up of the slide rule. This little slidey thing, the clear thing with the line in it, it's called the cursor. I really generally don't use it for the way that I use the slide rule, but it can help to get an alignment between the upper and lower scales. So one way to show a quick calculation, if we use the A and B scales, the A is on the top, the B is on the bottom. So you can use the 1 for like a base 1 on the A scale, and then the divide by multiply by number is going to be in the B scale. So just setting 2 to line with the 1, I'm going to have a divide by multiply by 2 scale. And by going up the scale, we can read that. 4 divided by 2 gives us a result of 2. 2 times 2 gives us 4. 3 to 6, 4 to 8, and so on. And now you notice here when we get to 5, we got 1. So then again, we do divide by and multiply by 10, factor of 10. So what's 6? Well, you can see right here, 6 is going to be 12. That's 10, 11, 12, right? 17 is 14, 13, 14, and so on, up the scale. And then use the same technique if you're calculating, you know, multiple digits. You calculate each decimal place and then add. So, but this is just a basic way of doing a multiplication division. And it's also the way that we do scaling. So if I'm doing a drawing and I want to make a drawing that's 2.5 times actual size, I'll go back here to the AB intersection and I'll set 2.5 to align with the 1. And now I've got this set up as a scale for doing my drawing. So 2 units of the actual I draw as 5 units. Could be millimeters, centimeters, inches, meters, whatever. But 2 of the actual is drawn as 5 for 2.5 scale. You know, 3 units is 7.5, and so on and up. And so with this, just setting this one time, you can do an entire drawing and get all of the sizing calculations that you need. And it, again, if you go past 10, you just calculate each decimal place individually. This is how slide rules are still handy for doing very rapid analog calculations. So the C and the D scales are a double decade scale. So I'm going to set the C, which is the 1, over the D 2. And so this scale will now be a divide by multiply by 2. So here we go. 2 times 2 is 4. 3 times 2 is 6. 4 times 2 is 8. And then, of course, divide by, you know, 8 divided by 2 is 4, da 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 da. Let's do some multi-digit multiplication using the C and the D scale. So if I want to find the result of multiplying 17 by 23, again, I'm going to be using the divide by multiply by 10 to get multiple digits. So I want to multiply 17 by 23. So I'm going to take the 1 on the C and put it over the 7 for 17. It's going to be 10 plus 7, 17. And put the cursor over 23, 2 plus 1, 2, 3. 23, and the resultant would be, again, another decimal place, 391. So, 17 times 23, 391. There you go. And that's how you do rapid calculation with an analog computer. Slide rule. That's how it was done. Let's try and do square roots. So, odd thing about the way that the slide rule works for square roots is, in order to find the square roots, you simply line up the scale, all the ones, so all the ones are in line. You're not going to move the middle piece out of position, and you're just going to use the cursor. For instance, let's get the square root of 2. Put the cursor over the 2 on the A scale, and the result is going to be read down on the D scale. 1.4 and a little over. 1.41. Square root of 2. Square root of 4 is 2. Square root of 9, 3. See? All right, so let's try using the right side of the scale for square roots using multiple digits. So, like, to find the square root of 80, I'm going to move the cursor over to the 8 on the A scale, and we'll read the result on the D scale, which would be 8.94 is what I'm reading. So 8.94. All right, let's get out the TI-30. So we get square root of 80. 8.9442. Okay, so at least to two decimal places, you know, it's accurate enough. Probably even accurate enough to do, you know, more than just drawing. You could actually make something to a tolerance like that. It's more than accurate for most everything you'd want to do. Let's try another one. Let's get the square root of 65. Line up the cursor as precisely as I can on 65. And the square root of 65 would be 8.06 is what I'm going to read that as 8.06, the square root of 65. Square root. Oh, 8.062. I've got to tell you, this is not a bad tool at all. And that's really fast. So, yeah. It's probably faster or as fast to get the square root of a number with the slide rule as with using a calculator. Let's try and get the square root of a large number. Let's say a square root of 740. So 24, let's see, reading this scale would be 20, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 27.2 and a little over. Okay, 27.2 and a little over. Okay, so let's see, 740 square root, 27.202. Ooh, see, this is really, if you got a good eyeball, it's pretty good. It's not bad at all, really. Slide rule, not bad at all. All right, that's it for this one. I want to thank my dad, if he were around, for letting me use his slide rule. I mean, well, anyway, thanks, Dad. And thanks to all of my patrons out there on Patreon who make all of this possible. If you like the videos I do, if you like the idea of my channel, consider becoming a patron, because it is the patrons that really keep up the lab, keep the lights on, all that stuff really helps out. If you want to become a patron, it's real easy to do. You just follow the link in the description, become a patron. Okay, that's it for this one. I'll see you around the lab real soon. Bye! Thank you.
you're watching. Friend, it's what I'm doing. Working at the bench.